All right, welcome everyone. We start our video out today with a shout out to Nepal. Every now and then we have, the world has these catastrophes, and there has been one in Nepal. There's been a big avalanche from, this is Mount Everest, and this is the Kathmandu area. It struck me, it's very similar to San Jose, where the area where I live. There's this large valley between mountain ranges like this, and it's about 700,000 people, similar in size to where I live. So I say, and of course, we were been affected by a big earthquake in 1989, Loma Prieta quake. But this one is has been quite bad, actually. And 8.1 is extraordinary, really. And this is downtown Kathmandu. You can see the buildings here, how they're the way they're built. And you say, "Uh-oh!" You know, you don't want to have a large earthquake in such a place. And I believe Kathmandu was flattened back in the 1930s or somewhere back there. And this is a mountain range in Nepal, beautiful country, Annapurna. It's just a country between Tibet and India. Okay, so. We give a shout out to the troubles and travails they're having in Nepal. As I said, here in the Loma Prieta earthquake 1989, there was extensive damage in San Francisco, severe damage in Oakland, the freeway systems collapsing. There's a lot of trouble. And so we have, at least, you know, in California, we have an understanding of earthquakes and what it's like to go through one, and the trauma and the, really is nothing like it. It's just, well, it's no fun at all. But life goes on. We do have a connection here with Kathmandu. There is this book. This book is Spaciousness, the Radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart, Longchenpa's Precious Treasure, the Dharma Dhatu, translated by Keith Dauman. And this book is published by, can you see this? No, because the light's not on it. Okay. Anyway, right here it says Vajra Publications, Kathmandu, Nepal. And I actually ordered this book from Kathmandu, and it came in a package from Kathmandu. And it's a quite a wonderful bookstore and publishing house they have there, producing, publishing a lot of tremendous books for the world to help with our overall spiritual quest. So it's an important bookstore and publishing house, Vajra Publications there. So we certainly wish the people of Nepal and Kathmandu a speedy recovery, and just to know that the people of the world are continuing to their spiritual focus and their spiritual efforts to realize our inherent freedom from this world, actually. Ultimately, this has to somehow boost them in a spiritual way. Kathmandu was, back in when I was young in the hippie generation, was the ultimate destination on the hippie trail to get to Kathmandu, Nepal, where, let's face it, that's where the drugs were. And so a lot of hippies made their way to Kathmandu for the hashish and the various drugs that were allowed there, you know. And it was a very, very freewheeling hippie kind of place with a lot of spiritual culture there, too. And you know, my generation, the baby boomer and the hippie generation, is very much aware of Kathmandu. It was like the hippie city in the East. I've never been there and don't really have had any desire to go there. And now, of course, they're in this real, very great trouble. And so again, a speedy recovery. And for everyone. Now, we talk about liberation. liberation. What are these books that they're publishing there in Kathmandu? What are they talking about? Well, they're talking about the same liberation that's always been talked about here in this world. But I have a slightly different emphasis. We have one emphasis here is a slightly new emphasis. And I know this is catching a lot of people like off guard. They say, well, where is this coming from? And it's coming from, it's not coming from Nepal exactly, although they're giving us a help and we assist and we thank them for that. It is actually coming from what we refer to as Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is a teacher, a spiritual teacher, and he has recently actually transmitted a teaching to the world, to the West, to the whole world. It came into New York City. Helen Schuckman was, and Bob Ted, Ted, William Tedford were teaching, I guess, at Columbia University in New York City. And Helen Schuckman began receiving these transmissions from Jesus, and her job was to take down in shorthand what was being said, and then the two of them worked together to flesh out this book in English to start out with, A Course in Miracles. And this, Jesus said, this is coming from Jesus. And Jesus is very much continuing his mission of salvation for all of us here. And so those who have really immersed themselves in A Course in Miracles, which I did starting in 1978, the reading part of it continued up until about 1997, going on to A Journey Beyond Words in 1994-ish, 1994, I believe. And then from there, continuing to refine it, reduce it, simplify. So it's been a long time focusing on that. Almost, 37 years or something like that. And those who have immersed themselves in this have come up with this new, sort of a new emphasis, actually, a new emphasis. And so, at least I have. And so when we give out this emphasis, you know, people from different traditions, whether it be Christian or Jewish or Islam or Buddhist or Hindu or, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, people may be saying, you know, what are you talking about? This is not in our tradition so much. You know, some of it sounds, that's because we have a new tradition. We have a new tradition, actually, a re-emphasis. And for my money, it is a clearer emphasis. It is, it's a very streamlined, very deep emphasis, and I actually prefer it. I prefer it to the other traditions. I'm aware of the other traditions and what they teach, but I prefer the emphasis that we're giving out here. It has a greater ecumenical feel to it. It seems to smooth out, you know, the roughnesses between all the various traditions, and it seems to focus on the root of the whole situation primarily. It doesn't focus on ethics or morals or, you know, a culture, civilization, all those kinds of things. It does not. It focuses in on the root of our problem. So I can speak of this with this emphasis that I certainly have taken to heart and I'm pretty clear about. It is that this world and human bodies and earthquakes and buildings and death and all of this is simply part of a very, very intricate, intense, prolonged effort on our part, on the part of spirit, which is what we really are, to camouflage its arrogance, to camouflages arrogance. So when we see these bodies in this world, etc., this is just a working of spirit, an imagining of spirit that is part of this camouflage effort. None of this has anything to do with what we are whatsoever. It's like something to throw God off track, so to speak. It's actually to throw our own awareness off track. Bodies, human bodies, nature, worlds, even this universe, you might say, is an attempt to throw our awareness off track and get us focused. Ultimately, we're camouflaging arrogance from ourselves. We're hiding from ourselves, you might say. So again, this world and bodies has, if you hit the dump, for instance, and you see all these piles of garbage, and you see all this stuff from people's homes, little bric-brac and toys and this mixture of stuff, and you look at it and say, what does that have to do with me? Nothing. Well, that's how much this world and bodies and nature have to do with our reality. Absolutely nothing to do with it. It's just a sort of a way we trick ourselves, deceive ourselves into camouflaging our arrogance. And our real problem is arrogance, spiritual arrogance, our spiritual pride. In the Christian tradition, it's talked about our biggest sin, worst sin, is spiritual pride. Well, that's our only sin, actually. This is the only problem we have in terms of what did we do wrong? What did we do wrong? Arrogance, meaning that we thought we could change reality. We could arrogate to reality the way that it has to be instead of accepting the way that it is. Okay, so we, spirit, believe that it could arrogate to God how God is. And now then spirit felt like a resistance from God. Instead of saying, wait, I can't do this, it's impossible, spirit said, oh, God is resisting this. We have a conflict here. Now, this is not true. God is not resisting anything. God doesn't, reality, perfection doesn't need to resist anything. There's nothing to resist. It's perfect. There isn't anything else but perfection. But we, when we tried to arrogate to God that God is imperfect, so we could believe that it's possible to be better than God, we felt this as if there was resistance from God. So we said, there's a conflict. So we said, okay, we need to resolve this conflict. I don't want to live in conflict. And so we said, okay, God, I'll give up. Spirit said, Spirit will give up believing that reality is imperfect if reality gives up believing that it's perfect. In other words, we both give up our position. But if you give up the position of being perfect, if God gave that up, what would there be? Since God is the one who establishes reality, if God says this that it's not, reality is not perfect, then it doesn't matter that we give up our saying that's imperfect. It will still be imperfect, right? So it's a trick on our part, and an arrogant trick on our part. And we claim that God accepted this deal. In fact, we arrogantly assert that God didn't accept this deal. This is a lie. It's an arrogant assertion. God cannot accept any deal at all. Perfection never even entertains any deal. It's impossible. There isn't any deal to make. God cannot make any deal. There's no deal to make. All is one. All is perfect. But we have asserted, arrogantly asserted, that this deal was made. Now, in order, there's two sides to a deal. And so in our imagination, we began working out this deal and imagine how this deal would work out, this imaginary deal, really. And in order to hide from ourselves the fact that we cannot change reality, we camouflaged our arrogance and claimed that we have this deal in place, okay, which really essentially changes reality. You see, it really does, except it's an imaginary deal. It was God never agreed to any deal with spirit. So two sides to a deal we're imagining, and we think, okay, we have to keep our side of the deal so that God keeps its side of the deal. And if we don't keep our side of the deal, God's not going to keep its side of the deal. And then in this situation, we feel very threatened. We feel very threatened because ultimately the realization that our arrogance is non-causative and hasn't changed reality a bit, that's in the background of our awareness, and we feel it as a great threat, as if, you know, the perfection of God is now seems to be a great threat to us, and yet we're holding that threat in abeyance because we have a deal in place, but we have to keep our side of the deal. So what is our side of the deal, if we've imagined? Well, bodies, time, space, process, form, bodies, worlds, nature, impermanence, and death, death, death. Okay, that's part of our side of the deal, that we're able to have temporary fixation in this so-called new reality, this new deal that we supposedly have with God, this new reality now, where we're believing in fixation in bodies, in crystallization of appearances, and crystallization of spaciousness, actually, which would be an imperfection in reality. But we have to make it only temporary. We can't maintain it all the time until we reach perfection, we think. And once we reach perfection, then we will have completed this deal. We will have bested God in really a contest. Kind of, this deal is like a contest, actually. And we will have proven that we're greater than God. But in the meantime, we have this temporary fixationness, which we call nature, which we call impermanence, and which we have the bodies, and the bodies having, you know, aging and dying and all this. This is all just us keeping our side of the deal, okay, we think we have with God. And salvation, you can say, ultimately, is the realization we don't have to keep our side of the deal. There isn't any sides to the deal because there's no deal. So, since there's no deal at all, why do we need to keep our quote-unquote side of the deal by impermanence, bodies, form, dying, all of this nonsense that we're suffering, all the suffering that we go through, okay? We don't need to. We don't need to at all. And ultimately, this realization will dawn upon us. A little moss flying around. So this is the emphasis that I have here. It comes from A Course in Miracles. Jesus talks extensively about our arrogance and how we try to arrogate to God, that God was now different and changed, and this is fundamental to this defense system. Now we defend it against recognizing this and accepting it. And what we say here is we repent. We repent. Jesus calls it forgiveness. Forgive ourselves, really. But we can use a term also. Repent means to change our mind, saying, hey, admit to ourselves, no, all of this is just sheer arrogance. This whole idea that I'm a body, that I have to die, that I'm bound to a world of dying. For time, space, process, and form, that there's even such a thing as time at all. This is all nonsense. This is all we've imagined all of this, actually. I'm not any of that. That's not even remotely what I am. I'm spirit. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm exactly as God created me, which means that God hasn't changed at all, right? God hasn't changed at all. We say, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. We're saying, God hasn't changed one bit, and therefore neither have I. So this ridiculous camouflaging of our arrogance, thinking that we have this deal, and then holding our side of the deal and saying, okay, we're holding our side of the deal. God, you have to hold your side. And we're in this sort of scary dance of competition with God. That's all entirely made up. That's all our imagination. It's all our wishful thinking. That's all it is. It's wishful thinking. That's it. And this is what Jesus tells us. All of this is just wishful thinking. Idle wishful thinking. Meaningless. Idle thoughts. Meaningless. Aimless. Nothing, really. There's no effect upon reality whatsoever. Now, the other traditions, also, for instance, Tibetan Buddhism, like Dzogchen, Radical Dzogchen, speaks of this, of course, in spaciousness, pure spaciousness. All is mere appearance, and it never crystallizes or fixates, and this is what we need to realize. So this is true. The realization is the same. The realization is, there isn't any deal with God. There's no possibility of appearance ever crystallizing or fixating. In other words, we're perfectly free. We cannot bind our freedom. It's impossible. So how can there be any thingness, so to speak, any process, any time? There cannot be. It's impossible. We're completely free. We cannot be defined. We are absolutely free. This is the nature of God, is absolute freedom. So we can realize this right now, that everything is mere appearance. Everything is mere appearance and nothing else. Everything that is arising arises as mere appearance and nothing else. So this would be a realization of radical Dzogchen. It would also be a realization of A Course in Miracles. It would be, you know, it's the same realization that we're aiming towards. It's just our emphasis of the context of this, it would be different. We're talking about how this is all just a camouflage of our arrogance and tracing it back to our desire to be greater than God, which the other traditions don't really get into very much, if at all. Which, you know, that's just the way it is. They have had a way of practice, getting to the realization. But I find that being aware of the overall totality of the context of why did we do this? Why are we in this ridiculous masquerade? Why? Was it just a whim? Well, yes and no. Yes and no. The whim was our desire to be greater than God. It's a whim because it's impossible. But we certainly had, in our adventurousness, the spirit of ultimate adventurousness, we said, hey, let's see if we can be greater than God. You know, that's what brought this about, all of this about, this masquerade, this camouflage, this ridiculous notion that we're bound by time, space, process, and form. That there, any of this is actually real, and we're believing that all this is real, but it's really not. Even this very instant, all is free, all is totally free, all is floating in pure spaciousness, and the realization of this is very possible for us. Right here, wherever we are, sitting in a room, whatever part of the world we happen to be in, right now, the realization that everything is actually not just floating, it is more than floating. Everything is not, it's kind of like a jellyfish floating in the ocean or something almost, where the ocean is there, but it's both outside and inside of the jellyfish, so to speak. The spaciousness is not, it's not a thing floating in like the ocean where inside the thing the ocean isn't there. Pure spaciousness is everywhere. Everything is completely saturated with it. So you couldn't even call it floating. But this is just a figure of speech. We are absolutely in total saturated abundance. In everything is in saturated abundance, equal saturated abundance in this all pervasive smoothed out smoothness right this instant. There's no difference at all anywhere in this regard. Now we can realize this and experience this right here, right now, no matter what our tradition is, no matter what our country we live in, or language we speak, or gender, our age, or our occupation, our resources. You know, no matter what, this is already true. There's nothing we have to do to make this true. There's nothing we need to add to it. There's nothing we need to subtract to it. Okay. It's impossible to add to it, and it's impossible to subtract from it. We can't grow it bigger, or we can't, you know, shrink it smaller. Okay. There's no way to grow it or to shrink it. No way to grow it or shrink it. No way we can affect this fact whatsoever. So one of the problems we have in the West, in the contemporary world, is we're beset by a materialistic culture, and which doesn't value this realization. In fact, it devalues it to an extraordinary extent. And also we have these ancient traditions that have been in the world for a long time, and maybe we're not, you know, part of that. And we're thinking, oh, you know, I mean, who am I to be enlightened? That's, you know, I can't do that. So we're up against this just sort of a feeling like, you know, if we're enlightened, that we need to defend it. And I realized today, well, maybe I will need to defend it, or whoever is enlightened, or anyone can be. Simply realize where you are, right, where everything is right now. That's it. Everything is already is in God, is in pure spaciousness right now. This is enlightenment. That's it. That's enlightenment. And we're going to have to defend it, because people are going to say, well, who are you? You know, who are you? What's your tradition? Who are your teachers? Why should we, you know, they're going to say, I don't like this. I feel uncomfortable. So they're going to ask questions, ask you to try to put you on the defensive about it. So we might have to defend defend this in some way. And I was sort of practicing this today. I was getting very feisty about it, and I realized it is possible to defend, but you have to be very adamant. I think that people will try to bully us, saying, you know, what do you, you know, who are you? Why do you, you know, why do you think you can be enlightened? You know, explain yourself and you know, justify yourself. They want, so they're not really, people are not really so boosterish about enlightenment. And, you know, you might be challenged. I want to challenge you to debate. I want to see if we can blah, blah, blah. That's all nonsense. You know, people say, what's your technique? What did you do? I think Longchenpa said, I just read there, anyone who depends upon a single fixed technique or something is a fool. You know, the path is an art, and it comes from the inner guru, the inner teacher, the inner savior, the inner divine grace, the Holy Spirit. And number one, the path is very simple. Practicing continual engagement with the spiritual focus. Okay, and two, managing your success. Those two aspects, that is the spiritual path, and then asking the inner spiritual master for guidance. That is the spiritual path. So I've taken the spiritual path. I don't care anybody from any time, any place in the world. I'm not going to be pushed or bullied by anybody because I've taken the spiritual path. I know what it's all about. The spiritual path is all about continual engagement with the spiritual path. And I've never taken a day off, okay? It's been continual. And then managing your success is all important. And I've paid great attention to this. And then asking the inner teacher for guidance and done that too. That is the spiritual path. Any place, any time, in any universe, whatever, of delusion, of arrogance, of camouflaged arrogance, that is the spiritual path, period. There's nothing more that needs to be said about it. Okay, so anyone can do it anywhere. It's just a matter of doing it. You have to remain continually engaged. And I know there's some watching this video who are doing just that and have done just that. So you're absolutely, keep in mind, you are doing exactly what needs to be done. And so you absolutely will come upon enlightenment. Absolutely. And you don't have to explain it any further than that. That's it. And so there's these dilettantes who you know, may think that just they breathe a certain way, and I'm doing this, and okay, that means I'm spiritual in a way. You know, what's been your practice? You know, your specific practice. You know, that's nonsense. You don't even have to answer that kind of stuff. I mean, I've done, you know, the inner guru, inner teacher, guides us in many, many brilliant ways, and I certainly have been guided in that way. A tremendous amount of study, book study, contemplation, and then tremendous amount of examining my valuing of the world. Went through a very, very intense phase of that, which is super important. Then all sorts of affirmations, all sorts of, different focuses that the Holy Spirit has advised to focus. And then, of course, some of the practices we practice here are actually very, very advanced practices, such as the already. I already know that I'm already enlightened. I already know that there's already no time. I already know that I'm already here. I already know that everything is already here, right now. I already know that everything is already here right now. I'm already experiencing the right here, right now-ness. Yes, I already know. I'm already experiencing the right here, right now-ness. This is actually, I didn't know this. The Holy Spirit told me to try to do this practice. Later on, I found out that in some of the traditions, it may be a Buddhist tradition, this is a very, very high advanced sort of practice. It may maybe the highest type of practice, actually. I think the Buddha actually in the famous he came upon this river and there was these people trying to cross this flooded river, and they were some were trying to get across in boats, some were making boats, some were, you know, they're all involved in some endeavor to get across this river. And then suddenly Buddha and his traveling party, they were on the other bank. And he said, you know, the People try to find all sorts of ways to cross this river of arrogance, forget, you know, the river of self-delusion. He says, but the wise are already on the other bank. They're already on the other bank. And he's pointing out this high practice, actually, of insisting that you're already perfect. You're already free. You're already true. Because that's a fact. You're already in God. There's nothing anyone needs to do. Anything, nothing needs to happen. Absolutely nothing needs to happen ever. Nothing can change reality whatsoever. Everything is already in reality. Everything is already in God. There's nothing outside of it whatsoever. So this is very advanced. So a lot of the practices we've given here, like I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. When it comes to like an assertion or an affirmation or like a mantra or a prayer, this is one of the highest prayers you can possibly say. Throughout all of history, I don't think you can come across a higher saying. I'm not going to say it's higher. I'm just going to say it's there at the peak. You know, it's on the peak, and maybe there's some others on the peak too. But this is a peak type of saying. It's very powerful, and I use it all the time. This is suggested by Jesus. So we are not at some sort of disadvantage not at all. Not at all. And I know that people look at traditional, maybe Judeo-Christian tradition, and think that if you're part of that tradition, that somehow you're at some sort of disadvantage and are not as sophisticated, etc. But keep in mind, A Course in Miracles, even though it uses a Judeo-Christian language, it actually tells a much clearer, gives a much clearer picture, vastly clearer picture. And so those who are up to speed on this are not at some disadvantage at all. You know, and you might even say that we're at an advantage in some ways, but let's just call even Stephen, you know, if you want to. We're not at any disadvantage whatsoever. Never will be either. Never will be. There's not someone's going to come along and just, you know, say, oh, you're at such a terrible disadvantage. No. Once you're able to see the whole root of the entire situation, I mean, I can read Radical Dzogchen and pay attention. I just say, yeah. That's great. Saying the same thing. I don't feel at any sort of disadvantage at all. You know, spiritual text, I don't feel at any sort of disadvantage, not in the slightest bit. You know, so absolutely, you might say that this is where we're at. We're not at any disadvantage. We're absolutely very strong spiritual aspirants and very much getting close to the fruit of enlightenment here, even in this materialistic Western paradigm that the world is going through, the darkness of the Kali Yuga, where we're really devaluing enlightenment is what this planet is up to. And as I've said before, the goal of this, of what you call darkness or devaluing truth, enlightenment, which is really just arrogance, is to make the camouflage so clever that it somehow becomes causative and therefore somehow makes the arrogance not arrogant, meaning it has effects on reality. And therefore we say, oh, it wasn't arrogance, it was true. We can be. Then this deal, then we believe, oh, there is a deal with God, and we can then work towards perfection. That needs to be our goal, is to try to perfect ourselves so that we can ultimately win this contest. This deal is that there's a contest between spirit and God, and we'll allow this to play out in time. And then if we can, so we try to, what, perfect, we're trying to progress, so we become what's called progressives. You know, we need to keep pushing. We need to get better society, better this. This completely overlooks the perfection that is already present. Okay, totally overlooks it. So we think if we make lies true, we won't have to repent, and we can just we say, oh, I was never arrogant. See, I was never arrogant. Everything I said is true. That God was imperfect, and we had an opportunity to become greater than God. And so, what do I need to repent for? I don't need to. So you have these people in this world who are very unrepentant, and they are devaluing enlightenment to extreme extent and valuing progressivism to a very strong extent. And they actually value lying. They value lying is actually, it's amazing. It's sort of like, you know, they're looking for who's the most clever liar. And if there's a real clever liar, they'll even elect them president. You know, they'll say, wow, you know, if I follow along on this path, you know, this is really going to help me succeed. We're going to be able to make lies true. So you have a collective collapse in this world where liars are valued above everyone else. The more clever a liar you are, the more the people, the progressives value you, actually. This whole desire to perfect ourselves instead of recognize the inherent abidance of all in the pure spaciousness of God that's already present. And to repent and to recognize we can't change God. We cannot change God. And there's no reason to try to perfect perfection, get better than perfection. It's impossible. And we're not really human beings. This is all a grand camouflage, a scheme of ours. And we are really spirit. I saw something, a blurb in the paper today about somebody talking about animals. Do animals express gratitude? And then the reply was, well, it's possible. And they say, well, the answer was, well, we humans express gratitude and we're animals too. So yeah, I mean, it's possible that animals express gratitude. You know, so this whole idea that we're animals is absolute arrogance, isn't it? Because that would be changing what God created. God created us as absolute perfection, as an extension of God, as absolute perfection. We're spirit, we're formless idea in essence. Okay, that's what we are. The notion that perfect idea in essence with absolute freedom is somehow a human body animal is absolute arrogance, sheer arrogance. Okay. Nothing could highlight it more strongly than this, really. It just is the most bizarre, intense sheer arrogance imaginable that somehow spirit is now this body, that what we are, our identity, is an animal form or something. That is just hilarious. And yet this is how the world thinks, and nobody seems to challenge it. You know, this is just utter arrogance. And people think they're being humble. Say, no, I'm just a humble person, a humble body. No, to say that you're this a human being in a world and time, space, process, and form is total sheer arrogance, nothing other than that. Because you're saying, hey, I'm no longer perfect spirit that's one with God and shares the co-creativeness of God. I'm formless essence. You're saying, no, somehow that got changed into this, you know, body of death, this animal grunting around here in this world, trying to find something to eat, trying to find shelter. This is, you know, just hilarious arrogance. But the world doesn't see that. They think they're being very humble by accepting this, you know, we're just this lowly people subject to death and all this suffering and everything, but we still have potential. You know, they say, we have potential, human potential. We got a lot of potential. We might even be able to someday perfect the human potential. And, you know, like, that's the goal, you see, the progressives. We've got to perfect this human potential. You know, that's just, it's hilarious. You know, when you recognize the arrogance behind this, it is quite funny. And this is what Jesus helps us with. Jesus really helps us see the arrogance behind all of this. And I would say this is a great point of emphasis that Jesus has. And I'm very thankful that he's given us this emphasis here, because it's not something that really comes through in the other teachings, traditional teachings, so much. Not so much. In fact, in traditional Judeo-Christian teachings, people have misconstrued that. We've misconstrued it. People, spirit, but they think that to be not arrogant is, oh yes, our spiritual pride is terrible, and so we say, I'm sorry, God, I'm just this lowly worm, I'm just this despicable human being, and how dare I think that I'm something more than that? And they think that that's repentance. That's the opposite. That is the arrogance. That is the arrogance. That's saying that you changed what God created. Ridiculously changed, impossibly changed. That's the arrogance. So if you want to get over spiritual pride, say, hey God, I'm still exactly as you made me. I am not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And so this is what Jesus tells us. This is the most, if you want something that's the most helpful, say this as often as possible and feel what it means. Try as much as possible, feel beyond the words. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And this says it all. This says it all. This is a statement of reality. This is a statement that cuts through arrogance. Okay, cuts through arrogance. And unfortunately, many in the world still cling to arrogance out of fear of, what I call the abyss. They're afraid if they don't have this camel delusion that they won't have anything. And of course, that too is arrogance, because that's asserting that it's either this deal or nothing. It's either this deal or nothing. If we don't have this deal, we don't have anything. That's sheer arrogance too. So the more we cut through this arrogance, the more we kind of lose our fear. And we say, oh, that's just arrogance. That's ridiculous. And the more the insights come, the more the insights come. We don't have to force insights. We take the first two steps on the path, which is continual engagement as often as possible. We stay engaged with our spiritual practice, our spiritual determination, and then we manage our success. And when we do those two right, then these insights arise. Just click. You'll just click and say, oh, my gosh, I see that. Like that. And then, you know, you manage that success. The better you are at managing success, the more is revealed, the more we cut through our arrogance. And it's true that most on this world are still enmeshed in extraordinary arrogance and have not yet repented. They have no choice but to do so. They cannot, you know, the path of trying to make lies true doesn't work. It will never work. It's impossible. So there's no direction but to go in towards repentance and saying, wow, cut through the arrogance and recognize it. And it's kind of funny seeing it. You catch yourself, say, oh my gosh, it's rather hilarious. These little tricks we've tried to play in ourselves, we see it and say, ah. we catch ourselves with our hand in the cookie jar and say, hey, wait a minute. That's not true. That's just arrogance. That's ridiculous. I don't have a deal. I don't have anything. What kind of nonsense is that? That's another deal that we're pushing onto God, saying, hey, God, if you don't accept this deal, you won't have anything. Right? Because if we say we don't have a deal, we don't have anything, that means that God must not have anything either, because otherwise we'd have everything. Otherwise we'd have everything. So we say, oh, I see that. Wow. So we are not these poor little spiritual waifs desperately in need of, you know, desperately in need of a spiritual path, and we're, you know, ignorant, and we, you know, no, need to be shown the way. No, we're not that at all. The opposite. We're actually very, very advanced and astute spiritual aspirants, and cutting through the arrogance. We're cutting through the arrogance to an extraordinary extent. Now, when I made this prayer for help for the world a while ago, November of, I think November 4th, 2013. And I just said, if there's any help anywhere, please, 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 please show up. Let us know you're helping us, and let's, you know, let's get some more help, because we're really struggling here. And then the response did come. in a dream, and I was contacted by someone. I didn't know who it was, but I recognized that they're some kind of spiritual teacher. Having some trouble with my breathing here. And I got some help, and ultimately it became revealed that this teacher was what you might say Longchenpa in the Bodhisattva form of here to help us, coming into the realm of seeing instead of knowing, which is what Bodhisattvas are. They're those who are no longer functioning entirely in the realm of knowing, but they've as it were have gone into a dream state of seeing that there isn't any problem with reality, and they're able to then work with us and help us. And you know, I said, wow, I didn't know who this Longchenpa was at all, and I had no idea. And gradually I found out who it was, and I said, wow, you know, that's pretty amazing. why would someone like that contact me? You know, I just didn't know what to make of it. But what did I do? I just continued on with my spiritual practice, continual engagement every day, intense engagement every day, and managing my success. I just kept doing what I've been doing for so long. That's all. And maybe that's why I was contacted by Longchenpa. Probably, right? Because he saw the discipline. You know, Longchenpa recognized, here's someone who's grounded in right spiritual practice. Here's someone who's disciplined. So this is, it's safe to contact someone like that, because they're going to keep continue on. And I just said, okay, well, that's great, but I'm, you know, still have to, you know, keep working on my arrogance. Same old, same old, same old. You know, don't break stride. And so that's, you know, that's probably, you know, what the situation is. So we're not, you know, this example, we're not these little orphans here necessarily in the now. Okay, I'm not a little orphan who's, you know, lost and struggling and doesn't know anything or like that. Not like that. I'm grounded in spiritual practice, right? Spiritual practice. I'm grounded in that. And ultimately, that is the path. That is the path. So, then in reading what Longchenpa has had to say, and it's focusing on spaciousness and focusing on all this, I said, oh yeah, yeah. I mean, this feels right to me. Feels right to me. I'm not overwhelmed by it or anything like that. So yeah, sure. Because I just stay grounded in the spiritual path. What do you do if Jesus shows up? And knocks on your door. What do you do if Jesus knocks on your door? Well, what if you do if Jesus knocks on your door? What do? You stay grounded in your spiritual path. You know, if Jesus knocked on my door, I'd say, great, wonderful. But, you know, still have to spend hours and hours. I spent like about 5 hours this morning, woke up at 5 a.m, got up late. It takes me almost like 5 hours to get out of bed because I have to reconnect with where I was previously in the night before. And the progress is so fast and so intense. I have to spend like 5 hours getting back in sync with it. You know, I can't even get out of bed without 5 hours of intense spiritual contemplation and work. And then do out, you know, a couple hours and a half of taping. And the rest of the day is also focused on saying, I'm not a body, I am free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. So I'm immersed in this intense spiritual effort. So if Jesus knocks on my door, I'm going to continue to be immersed in spiritual effort just like before. The arrogance is still there. I say, well, you know, great. What do you suggest I practice, or what do you suggest in way of practice and right focus, and how can I cut through the arrogance even quicker? You know, that's all, and then just have to keep doing it. So. If those who are able to stay grounded in everyday practice, you are the ones who are advanced, actually. And this is what I've gradually come to realize. And the experiences that I've had, I share them with the world to encourage people, you know, to say, hey, this is what can happen, will happen for you if you, the more grounded you are in spiritual practice, this is what will happen. You will begin to rub elbows with some great teachers along the way, because they know you're going to stay grounded in your practice. You will realize you have to manage your success. You're gonna, and that's very tough to do. You have to stay humble enough to keep practicing, keep working at it intensely. Say, hey, I'm not there yet. I'm still suffering from, you know, this ridiculous arrogance and this continuity fear that I have, and so just have to keep on working. And whatever you do, keep a spiritual theme about it. Stay in touch. Whether if you're doing graphics, if you're doing this, that, stay in touch with spiritual truth, the journey beyond words, ultimately to experiencing the absolute smooth evenness. You can call it peace, you can call it stillness, you can call it smooth evenness of pure spaciousness, that everything is saturatedly abiding in that, with no inside and no outside to the abidance. There's no inside or outside to the abidance of everything whatsoever. Nothing has any inside. There's no difference between anything's inside and outsideness of its abidance. It's all smooth. It's all even abidance right now with everything. There's no difference between a rock and some air. No difference whatsoever. It's all 100%. Pure spaciousness itself, actually, it's complete saturation, even saturation. There's not any aspect of anything that is not 100% within, abiding within pure spaciousness. And we have to get past this inside-outsideness in which we're working on it. And it'll click. At some point, it will click. I'm still waiting for it to click really powerfully for me. I've had several experiences of it clicking in, and I say, ah, it's that simple. Oh, wow, how could I have ever missed that? That's crazy. It's arrogant to overlook it. Very arrogant to overlook this. and it's a little difficult to explain because we have concepts of inside and outside and thingness and all this like that. But if, let's say, we measured, you know, from here to here, and realize that there's this spaciousness between the two. Isn't this bottle entirely within that spaciousness? All of the bottle? And isn't the outside of it also within that spaciousness equally? And so there's no difference between inside and outsideness. Okay, in abidance, in beingness. In beingness. You might call it beingness. The beingness, the being abidance of all is equal. Inside and outside, there's no difference of inside and outsideness at all, of beingness. There's only absolute beingness, just one absolute beingness, and this one absolute beingness is present right here, right now, always. And when we feel this, when we experience it, you know, that's enlightenment. That's it. We don't need to worry about endless elaborations about it, you know. No, not at all. That's the realization, and that's the abidance and the absolute oneness of being. All is that one beingness, right here, right now. No inside, no outside. And so managing our success is very important. I've had a lot of work with that, had to throughout the years, as I've had contact with various teachers and great historical teachers, and it's just like, wow, it's a shocker, you know. It really is. And yet I just said, well, I just got to keep working. What else can I do? I don't know. There's nothing else I can do. And just try to benefit and try to take to heart what is imparted to you, and keep working. Keep working on familiarity. Keep working on familiarity. And you might say entitlement. We're all entitled to experience this being, this one all-inclusive beingness that all is right here, right now. We're all entitled to it because that's our identity. That's the truth. We can't escape it. You know, we have to do it. There's another way of putting it. We can't escape it. It's not like there's something else going on, like there's some inside and outside work going on. There's no inside, there's no outside in terms of beingness at all. Can we say that the spaciousness that is this area here where this bottle is, can we say there's an inside to it and an inside to it and an outside to it? Pure spaciousness, not air, but is there some inside or outside? Doesn't this occupy spaciousness? And isn't spaciousness everywhere? All things are occupying spaces. Where is the inside and where is the outside? The occupation is 100% the same. It's 100% the same. We're not talking about some thingness. Pure spaciousness is zero-dimensional. Zero-dimensional in terms. So you cannot say that something there's an inside or an outside or upside, a downside, or any of that. None of that is operable at all. So we all are abiding in this all-inclusive one beingness right here, right now. And this is always the case. And this is what we ultimately experience. That's all. And we may have to defend, you know, we say, well, sure, I'm enlightened, absolutely. And people say, well, how did you do that? You know, we might have to defend it to some extent. And I try to help you with that. And we try to help one another here, saying, well, took the spirit right, spiritual path, which is what? Continual engagement with the spiritual path, continually engaging with the challenge of the spiritual path, and then managing success as you go along, and just keep staying with it, staying grounded in that intense dedication to it, stay grounded in your intense dedication. That is the path. That's all you need to say. That's all that needs to be said. See, most of the world, they devalue that so much, they can't even understand what you're talking about. I say, what do you mean? I mean, you read some book, you mean? You read some book? What book do I need to read? That's funny. You know, I spent like 15 years continuously reading A Course in Miracles. I may have read, some parts over hundreds of times. And not only just reading it, but read it and then stop and contemplate about it, sometimes for an hour or two, just say, what in the world is Jesus saying here? Wow. And so I just engaged continuously in just, wow, this is just incredible. This is just fantastic, wonderful, amazing what's being said. And just, wow, and I have to calm down. Then I go back to the reading, and I get more wow and have to calm down. And it just went on like this for 15 years, one book. It was actually, at that time, it was three books, text and workbook and definition of terms or something. What was the last part? But manual for teachers. I guess it was manual for teachers. I just kept on going over and 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 over like that. And is Jesus really real? I mean, is he really saying this? I can hardly believe that someone's actually saying this, that I'm reading this. That can we really even entertain this here in this world? I mean, that's the question I had. Is it even possible to entertain this? I feel like it's taboo. It's just the teaching is really very advanced teaching, and I just wondered, is it possible to even entertain this? And it's difficult. difficult. It's like a hot potato. You say, wow, I don't know if people are going to agree with that. You know, and of course, the world will certainly devalue it. They say, no, that's twist. Let's twist it somehow. let's slow down. Let's twist it. Let's not be in a hurry here. Come on now. Let's give it some time so we can twist it. And Jesus said, don't give it time. Come on, don't give it time. Go. The problem is if you start giving it too much time, you know, say, well, you give this a, let's give it a lot of time, you know, a couple hundred years, a couple thousand. Eventually, we'll be able to twist it. And Jesus says, no, just keep going as fast as possible. Don't get hung up on any of that. Don't get hung up on the words. Just keep looking at what it's pointing to. The essence. Just keep letting the essence permeate you. And this is how you need to take any teaching, is let the essence permeate you. Don't worry about the words. Don't worry about the structure so much. Of course, we make assertions, but we understand that's very, very potent pointers, right? Very potent pointers. And the point also there is let the essence permeate us. Which the essence, what it's pointing to, is that essence already is permeating us. It's permeating everything equally. There's no inside or outside at all to reality. There's no inside or outside at all to reality anywhere. It doesn't exist in terms of beingness. There's no upside. There's no downside. There's no this side or that side. There's no boundary. There's no center. There's no circumference to reality at all. So this smoothed out evenness, this very smoothed out evenness, that is God, that is beingness, And so we absolutely all must experience that. That is the fundamental experience of beingness. And this is here right now. Right here, right now. Yes, I already know that fundamental beingness is right here, right now. Yes, I already know that beingness is right here, right now. There's no inside or outside to it at all. There's nowhere to generate it from. Nowhere to generate it to. There's no generation of it. There's no consumption of it. You cannot generate it. You cannot consume it. If you have this bottle and you're going along and you say, I'm this great whale, I'm consuming spaciousness as it moves along, you know, just I'm devouring spaciousness. No, it's not devouring any spaciousness. You cannot devour spaciousness. You cannot consume it. And likewise, if you pour out the water, you say, I am adding to spaciousness. You don't add anything at all. The water you pour out, that too occupies, that too is within pure spaciousness entirely. You don't add to it, you don't subtract from it, you don't generate it, you don't consume it. Nothing is. There's no inside, no outside game. There's no game going on at all, actually. There's absolutely no game at all taking place. Okay, and we, again, don't struggle with insight. Just say, okay, well, that, you know, that's there, and it will click. Ultimately, insights kind of you don't know when they may just click. You just may just say, okay, it just let it happen. Don't try to conceptually force it. Say, come on, you know, give me that conceptual realization. Don't try to force it like that. How are we doing? We got a... All right, we're doing well so far. Once we abide in being in God and in beingness, that is enlightenment. That's enlightenment. We don't need to try to adopt some view about it. Yeah. That means there's some outside, inside, outsideness to it. No, it is enlightenment. That's it. This is it. And people might say, well, but what's your viewpoint on it? Meaning, you can't really be enlightened. I mean, you've got a viewpoint of enlightenment, right? That's what you're saying. I said, no, I'm not. We're not saying that. We're saying, you know, I am enlightened. For instance, we'd say, no, I'm abiding in no viewpointness, in non-dual, no viewpointness. Of course, duality means there's a viewpoint, which is in something you're viewing. Or there's an inside and outsideness, so to speak, to beingness. There isn't any inside or outness, so there isn't any viewpoint to express. I'm just where all is. All is where all is. And nothing is happening. There's no generating and there's no consuming happening. There's no contamination. There's no stretching. There's no shrinking. There's no building of it. There's no tearing down of it. Nothing is happening to beingness at all. It's always perfect. And so you just abide in that perfection and you see, nothing's happening to it. I see. Nothing's happening to it whatsoever. You're abiding in the seeing that nothing's happening to it. And if you want to call that a viewpoint, you can, but it's healed perception. It's healed perception. And this enables us to stay in the world and help and share with, encourage others. But it's to say, well, it's the viewpoint of realizing there is no viewpoint. Well, to say that that's a viewpoint from the dualistic perspective is ridiculous, of course. So you have to, in order to really get help on the spiritual path, one needs to shift out of sheer arrogance a little bit, right? You cannot remain in sheer arrogance and make any progress at all. You have to try, say, you come to any teaching, any sharing with humility, great, severe modesty and humility, where you're shifted out of the arrogant viewpoint. And as soon as you do that, then these things like the viewpoint of no viewpoint doesn't bother you at all. You get it. You see, I understand that someone is just encouraging me, that's all. They're not playing a trick on me. They're not trying to trick me or anything like that. It's just someone is encouraging me to, you know, to go beyond words. That's all. And so there's no upset at all about it. Whereas if you're in the standpoint of sheer arrogance, you will feel very upset about this, which I call level confusion. You get level confusion will trip you up very badly. And I've certainly experienced this as I have been working on my own arrogance throughout the years. You know, it used to be, you know, like, wait a minute, this just causes me, I'm so upset. What do you mean? How could you say that? This is, you know, and we just like, what do you mean? You said the viewpoint, you said there's no viewpoint, and then you said there's a viewpoint of no viewpoint. Well, that isn't that a viewpoint? You know, and you get into this inner dialectic, you know, which just drives you crazy. But as soon as you shift out of sheer arrogance into severe modesty, severe humility, managing your success, which is full stop in the wowness, where you're willing to be patient with your success, okay, then it doesn't bother you hardly at all. You know, it still might give you a little bit, but you realize it's almost gone. Like, wow, I'm not really troubled by that. I'm not taking offense. I'm not getting upset. I'm not getting agitated at all. So again, managing our success is really the key, staying engaged and managing our success. And if we don't manage our success, we won't stay engaged. So I'd say the number one focus is managing your success, which I call full stop in the wow. This is what we're using the term, full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow. And because the success is wow, you feel this, oh my gosh, this is fantastic. Look, I'm actually succeeding on the path. I didn't think I could. This is amazing. I thought I was some fool, you know, but and yet here I suddenly see this. I just, oh my gosh, this is, and just, you know, you can hardly Believe it. It's like someone, like an artist or something, starting out, and they're like a guitar player, pianist or some, playing some instrument, and you see these virtuosos are so good at it, and you just think, there's no way in the world I can ever do anything like that. It's impossible. It's ridiculous. You think, like, especially when you start trying and you're so clumsy and you don't know what you're doing. And you say, I'm a fool. I'm an idiot. But you keep practicing, 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 and one day you play something and you say, wow, that sounded pretty good. I was able to do something, a little bit like that, just a bit like it in here, but I was able to do something. Wow. And you kind of sit back and just say, "Holy cow! I'm better than I thought I was. I thought I'd never be able to do anything, but now I'm able to do at least a little bit of wowness." Okay, so you have to manage that success. In order to become that virtuoso, you have to manage that success. The virtuoso got that way by managing their success. Because they too went through these steps, like, oh my gosh, I'm really getting so much better. In fact, now, wow, I'm really playing great. Oh my gosh, that's amazing. Me? I didn't know I could do that. I was seeing a video about this session player, recording studio session player and guitar player. And he said, when we started this business, that I was a friend of this who started or something, and I didn't even know how to play guitar at all. Or whatever they played, I didn't know. I think it was a guitar or bass, but I didn't. So I taught myself how to play, and even then, I didn't know how to read music. I didn't know how to do anything. I taught myself through the years, and it got better and better. But I didn't think I could ever, be good enough. And now here he is, having played on all these songs, and he's terrific, But you can tell he's still like, wow, I'm just this is really, I really had a great struggle in getting here, because I started out so lowly, and now, and I didn't, it's been such a steep, advancement of success, that it's really, you could tell the humility of him. It's just this is really, wow, this got quite amazing. So here we are on the spiritual path, reaching the fruits of the path, and we say, wow, I thought I was just an incompetent fool. It wasn't long ago that I maybe was this incompetent, arrogant fool. But keep in mind, we're not really incompetent, we're just arrogant. It's extremely arrogant, thinking that we don't need to do this. I don't need to do this. That's arrogance. So as you drop the arrogance, you begin to be successful, and you find out you're no fool at all, actually. You're very, very wise, actually. Everyone is. It's just the arrogance clouds that. Because the arrogance says, I don't need to recognize the arrogance. I'm going to make lies true, and when I do, that'll prove I was never arrogant in the first place, which is the epitome of arrogance, isn't it? That's the trap. Arrogance basically says, I don't ever have to admit I'm arrogant, because I'll make lies true, and that proves was never arrogant. This is the bind that we're all in, the bind, you see. It binds us, doesn't it? And whenever you try to recognize arrogance, arrogance says, no, you don't need to do that. Yeah, that's the ego advising us. No, you don't have to do that. What are you doing? You're crazy. I have a better way for you. That's what the ego says. I got a better way for you. Just hold. Just stay. We're almost there, the ego says. Or the world. Look at the world. Excuse me. Look at the world. We're almost there. We're almost there, almost there. We almost defeated God in this race contest we're having. We're almost proving that we can perfect our potentiality and all this stuff. So don't quit now, the ego says. Don't quit now. We're almost there. Why are you looking at your arrogance and deciding to repent? That's ridiculous. That's so difficult. You're going to have so much trouble. Well, that part, it's partially right about that, because there it is difficult. Because the continuity fear we have. But the other part, it's wrong. Because we have to do it. We have to do it. We have no choice. It says, well, why do you want to do that? Because we have to. It's not what I want to do, it's what I have to do. And ultimately, it is what I really want to do, because that's the only way to be truly happy. So we have to do it. We have to do it. So managing one's success is the key. Managing one's success is the key. And that's ultimately between you and your own path. You see, you have to evaluate what is it that brings this wow up for you and manage your success. And no one else can directly do that for you. You know, for instance, if you're a musician, you play something, maybe somebody else will just say, it's no big deal. But for you, maybe you've been trying to do this for a long time and get this certain sound or whatever, and then you do it, and you say, oh my gosh, all my life I've wanted to be able to do that, and I just did it. I know how to do it now. That's a huge wow for you. Huge. And someone else might not, you know, an outsider would have no idea about that whatsoever, whether, you know, what they'd say, shrug their shoulders and say, why is that some wow? I don't know why. But for you, it's just gigantic. So everyone has to manage their own spiritual path. Everyone has to manage their own spiritual path. The similarities to all paths is managing your success. That is a universal similarity between all paths. Also, staying engaged with the path is a universal similarity between all paths, those two. And then enlightenment is universal similarity too, to all paths ultimately. But the wows may differ in various ways. And you have to be sensitive to your wow, okay? So you cannot just follow somebody else telling you, well, this is what you should feel wow about. You should feel wow about this and this and this and this. Everyone is unique in the terms of what is it that gives them this wow reaction. You know, you may have been stuck in your arrogance in a certain way for so long, and finally you've been able to drop the arrogance and the fear there, and suddenly the arrogance resolves, and suddenly you see, oh my gosh, you know, now I see what I've been bound by this for so long. And now I see it. I'm not bound by it anymore. And that's huge for you. Just huge. And then you have to honor that. You know, you have to honor it and be patient with yourself as you resonate with the success that gives you a shock of a mixture of elation and trepidation, because elation wants to surge forward and finish, and trepidation is, whoa, continuity fear, I'm not so sure. And there's this sort of blending of the two, and it resonates throughout your beingness, as it were. You say, wow, I think I just need to take a moment here or two and just let this settle down a little bit. Yeah. It can be anything for you. You know, everyone's can be different about that. There's a lot of uniqueness on the path. Also, there's a lot of sameness too, because certain recognitions are similar. You know, when you catch a glimpse of the oneness, you know, that's a wow. for sure. And that oneness is always there to glimpse. And so everyone will glimpse that at some point, start glimpsing it. You start glimpsing your freedom, and that's a big wow. But so there's both some similarities and uniqueness, but it's enough unique where everyone has to manage their own path. You can't have you cannot impose a universal curriculum upon anyone, upon the world. You cannot impose a universal curriculum in terms of what is the wowness. Okay, you can have wowness about this and this and this, and not about this and this and this, and try to structure the wowness. You can't really do that. That's futile. That's why Ramana Maharshi said, you know, people go around, in the world, they go around trying to remove all the stones and thorns from all the entire world so they don't bruise their feet and hurt their feet as they're walking about. He says, it's a lot easier to put on a pair of shoes or sandals. You know, put on a pair of sandals. This is what he's getting at. Manage your own wow. Manage your own wow. Okay, manage your own wow. Don't go thinking that you can impose this universal curriculum on everyone, and that everyone, and you have to do it that way. No, that's not how. You have to do it your own wow, manage your own success, and you will much more quickly, you will ultimately reach enlightenment that way. Because, you know, trying to control other people's wow, that's futile. That's right. It's a waste of time. It's we're supposed to feel wow about this and not about this. You get into this, you know, progressive ideology of controlling everybody, which is what's happening in the world now, more and more, more and more and more. And thinking that's the way. You know, I got to make everybody agree that my wow is their wow. You know, that I'm wow about this. And you have to be wow about it at the same time. We all have to do it together in the same page. You know, this is nonsense. This is absolute nonsense. And it can never, never succeed that way. There is a uniqueness, because our arrogance plays out in such complex patterns of defensiveness that there does seem to be a uniqueness taking place in our defenses, that we seem to be identifying with a unique pattern of defensiveness, similar patterns, but also uniqueness to it also. And so we have to manage our own path. I can't tell anyone, you have to feel wow about this. You have to feel wow about this. Now, I'm aware that recognizing your freedom, it most certainly brings up a wow. There's no question. However you do it. And I can say, well, if you look at it this way, you can recognize your freedom. But that doesn't mean that that's exactly how you're going to look at it, or that you will do it that way. And you'll probably have your own unique way of looking at it. But then when you do experience the wow, then you will know, oh, wow, I just suddenly recognize, you know, I entered a new realm. What is this? I just feel like I was able to see so clearly now. Wow, what, you know, I dropped my arrogance a little bit, and so you'll feel this, wow. Now, A Course in Miracles is interesting. It's a self-study. Jesus, I believe, is really emphasizing this, the uniqueness and the necessity for us to manage our own path. That's actually, maybe he's saying that's a quicker way. Because when you start delegating authority to the wow, like what am I supposed to feel wow about, to a tradition, to a lineage, to a structure, to, you know, religion, to all this stuff, you tend to stagnate. You really tend to stagnate. And because the whole purpose of that is to slow things down, actually, and fail. A lot of it is. It can be. So, A Course in Miracles is self-study. And that's what I always did. I never went to anybody to explain it to me. No groups, no explanation. I just studied it myself and felt the impact of it. And felt the wow of it. And then I would, if I read something online of somebody else, I'd always scratch my head and say, what are they talking about? I don't get it. Yeah, even now I read, you know, look at videos on A Course in Miracles and various those who are doing it, and I don't get it. So I don't get their emphasis. I don't get it at all. I said, why are they emphasizing that? I don't understand that. And then attempts to kind of standardize it and say, this is what you're supposed to, you know, I don't get that at all. I really don't get that. I'm not part of that. That's not where it's at. I don't believe that Jesus' purpose is to create a new religion at all. In fact, I believe it's to boost us beyond all of that and to manage our own path. Manage the success of our path. We have to become successful managers of our own path, our own success. We have to. We're not trying to start a new religion. Trying to go down that road. Say, I'm the one who has the, you know, the right interpretation of the wowness of it, and this is, you know, I want to tell everybody about this. This is what you should be, how you should be looking at it. This is how the wow should be. And just no. No. Don't go there. Don't go there. Ultimately, of course, the goal is the same for everyone. So we can say that's the same for everyone. Ultimately, staying engaged with your spiritual path and managing your success, ultimately, that is something that's common to everyone. So I can say that in terms of that, those are absolutes. Those are absolutes. But there is a strong uniqueness to everyone's path, strong uniqueness to it. And you have no choice but to manage your wow. And I see so many people looking for teachers to tell them, you know, what to feel wow about. And you know, like, you know, that's not it. That's not it. And we tend to default back into that, you know, which is really putting the brakes on very strongly. You have to feel the wow for yourself. No, you can't have anyone feel it for you. It's like, okay, you can't just say, well, someone's feeling the wow for me, so I'll identify that wow. Okay, now I conceptually understand that there's a wow around this particular sentence or insight or something. So now I get it. I conceptually get it, that there's a supposed wow about it, but they're not feeling it. So there's someone else is feeling it for them. They think, okay, I'm identifying with that and conceptualizing. There's a wow there, that somehow they're making progress. They're not. That's just creating another. That's just making another religion is what it's doing. And we certainly don't need that. We've had enough religions. And Anamai Ma said, they asked her, hey, we want to build these temples for you. We want to build these. She says, we have enough temples. We have more than enough temples. I don't want you building any temples for me. I don't want you doing all these, you know, there's more than enough. You know, get to work managing your own success of your own path. That's what I ask you to do. So it's the same. Jesus saying, hey, we have enough. We've had enough of religion. Now, you know, it's time for you to take responsibility for your success. Now, it's very true that someone's enlightened can certainly trigger wows in everybody, but there'll be different wows. You know, you get some teacher who's enlightened and people come to see them, and a lot of, you know, there's all this wow going on, but you might ask them, well, why are you feeling wow? And everyone will have a different answer for it. You know, this is why I'm a spider spinning a web here. This is why I'm feeling the wow. they'll say that. And someone else will say, well, this is, each one will have a different take. It's the nature of perception that it's variable like this. And everyone sees it in their own way. It's like everyone living in their own universe, actually, perceptually. But certainly, if you're enlightened, you're going to trigger wows all over the place. There's no question about that. But what you have to do is you have to and insist that you don't get put into, like, I'm founding a new religion of structuring what is it that you must feel wow about and all that kind of thing. That's where it gets problematic. There's a fine line here in this world. But again, if you drop your arrogance and you shift into a mood of repentance, you will see, you will feel what's appropriate. You will know. You won't get caught up in level confusion. Like if we say that I have the viewpoint of no viewpoint, you won't be bothered by that. You understand, oh, okay, that's just, that itself triggers a wow. And if you're really severely humble and repentant, you will find that just about everything, it triggers a wow in you. It's you're being continuously triggered, wow, 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 wow. And then you have to just spend all your time managing that. You're on the fast track. That's fast tracking it. But you can do that. Absolutely, you can do that. You might slow down at times and go, wow, this fast track is really something. I can't find a viewpoint. You know, I'm going so fast, I can't find a viewpoint. Well, you can rest in the view. I have a viewpoint that there is no viewpoint. And even that viewpoint isn't needed. I have the viewpoint of recognizing that the viewpoint of no viewpoint isn't needed. You can say that. And you can, you know, you can infinitely expand and continue that on and on and on and on. But there's no need to, because if you're speaking to those who are in the mood of repentance, they don't need that. They're not into cleverness, actually. It's enough to just get the simplicity of it. Cleverness has to do with trying to make lies true. But when you're really in the mood of repentance, you're not into excessive cleverness. You're just into, you can just easily see it. It's very simple. Just, oh, wow. Okay, I recognize what's being pointed to is there's no what in what is being pointed to. Ah, There's no answer in what is being answered. You know, arrogance doesn't have any answer. Arrogance doesn't need to be answered because there's no question. See, what question is arrogance posing? No question at all. It's unquestionably untrue from the very beginning. So there isn't any answer. We don't have to answer arrogance. Nobody has to answer arrogance. So ultimately, what's the final answer? We just realize we don't have to answer arrogance. That's the final answer. How will all this end? We do by realizing we don't have to give any answer at all to arrogance. And then that's it. That's the end. So, all praise to all the teachers, and we certainly give praise to Jesus because Jesus has been knocking at our door for sure. And you know, the ego thinks that the ego has Jesus trapped in a religion. No, the ego does not have Jesus trapped in any religion. That's the ego's belief, okay, that they've got Jesus all packaged up in some religion. Not true. Not true, not true, not true at all. And of course the ego is all huffy and puffy about that, saying, I got Jesus trapped. What are you talking about? And we say, no, Jesus lives, Jesus saves today. You know, Jesus saves every day. Jesus saves right now. Jesus always is saving right now. You don't have him. Nobody has Jesus in a package that is, you know, it doesn't work that way. Jesus is free. Jesus is absolutely free. Right now, all being is free. Absolutely free right now. So, we're getting the benefit of not being stuck in any tradition, not being stuck in any religion, taking responsibility for our success, taking responsibility. After all, it's our arrogance that we need to cut through. It's our arrogance that we need to cut through. And nobody can cut through that for us, actually. We have to cut through it, you know, ourselves. And so we have to take responsibility for that. We can be encouraged, for sure. Absolutely, we can be encouraged. But ultimately, we have to accept. And we have to evaporate our continuity fear. We have to accept this. We cannot get someone to do it for us. Where are we at here? We're doing well. Okay. Very warm day in California today. It popped out of nowhere just yesterday. The weekend was cold and blustery. And suddenly, today it was like 89 degrees here. It's just like summer. It's a quick shift. Quick shift. Then tonight is supposed to, the fog layer is supposed to come in, marine layer we call it, and cool everything off. And tomorrow's going to be cool. And then the next day, a couple days of coolness. Then supposed to, temperature supposed to pop back up to 90 again for a couple days. And then it's supposed to cool back down. So that's what happens when you live next to a big air conditioner called the Pacific Ocean. But even the Pacific Ocean is so warm right now. Comparatively warm, that I wonder what kind of effect that's going to have on everything. Probably a lot, actually. I mean, what is it, 5 degrees warmer than normal? Some really high. I mean, that's going to have an effect on the weather for instance, of the Bay Area here. Really. It may have a much warmer climate. Temperatures here. They're cracking down on watering here, except there's really no enforcement of it. They say, you can't do this, no new lawns and, you know, all this stuff. But enforcing it well, you know, warning, second time you have someone coming out to your house and then goes through this council and this bureaucracy and that and that and that, and ultimately you may get fined $50 or something. But you know, basically there's no teeth to it. Yeah, but hopefully people can, well, not everybody's abiding by it, that is for sure. The attitude is kind of divided about people who are very vigilant about it, and those who are just basically saying, I got plenty of money, I'm not going to worry about it. I can purchase the water. And it's pretty much divided along those lines right now. Here in drought-stricken California. They're still putting in, someone told me they were just up in a city, California, and they're just putting in massive subdivisions with huge amounts of grass everywhere. They're just surrounded by grass, golf courses and grass everywhere. New, it's all new. What are they thinking? What are they thinking? It's, you know, developers have this development mind for a long time, and they want to get their money back from all the money they put into it, and they want to sell the homes, you know, so it puts, everybody gets put in a, you know, a tight spot, that's for sure. But they're not going to be able to keep those lawns going, and an artificial lawn is quite expensive to put in, very expensive, actually. It'll come down in price because of demand, but it's not the same, really. It's a little odd. They may have to do that on golf courses because they can't water. You cannot, in San Jose, you can't water, you can only water the putting green now. You can't water anything else unless you're using reclaimed water in San Jose. So what's going to happen to the golf courses? You know, they'll turn into dirt. I don't know what they're going to do. Better learn to hit off dirt if you play. I haven't been playing. Because this is, I've been intensely, you know, it's like if you're, you know, it's my opinion, if you're like president, you know, you better spend every day working at your job. You don't just go off play golf. If you're trying to do something, if you're trying to really help have a position of leadership or encouragement of the world, you know, and we're in an extreme crisis now in the world. I just said, hey, you know, I just can't go do that. I've got to, you know, keep grinding away here. So I've played, like, you know, now it's like once in the last year, maybe. That's it. And only a couple times in the last 2 years. I just, you know, I say, maybe today I can go. And I say, nah, you know, I got a tape. It's better if I better keep grinding away at this. It's too important. You know, but maybe someday I'll get out. I don't know. It's possible. It'd be nice. I haven't had a break in a long time. My health, I'm out of shape, stressed out and everything. But yeah, you know, if you're doing a job, you got to give it everything you've got. And funny enough, there may not be any golf courses around pretty soon, actually. I was warned about that quite some time ago. I think it was like 2008. I was warned there's going to be a water problem. And, of course, that was, the drought started in about, what, 2010? It was that, so the drought was coming. Actually, it was on its way at that time. This is the fourth year, so maybe it started in 2011. I was given a heads up, and some very odd stuff happened. And I realized, there's going to be some sort of problem with water here. I don't know what exactly it is. And, well, we've certainly got that problem now. To put it mildly, you know, the drought may last for 10 years. Who knows? Australia had a drought lasted 17 years recently. If we have a drought that lasts that long, California is going to be, I can't even fathom what it's going to be like. So we're just kind of hanging out here, you know, normalizing the intense efforts we're making, realizing, sure, we can still talk about the weather and talk about a few things that we're, you know, it's just this is normal to us. This is normal. Intense engagement on the spiritual path is normal. Just as normal as your commute in the morning. Get in the morning, you got to commute. That's, you just get used to it. It's not like we're in some whacked out state that we can't even think about. We don't, not even aware, you know, of anything. We can, it's not like that. So we can still get dinner, still do the dishes. We can still, you know, drive. We can still do everything. Just like someone goes to work and they spend all day doing computer, you know, coding software. You know, I mean, they can still function, right? But yet they're intensely focused on whatever it is, these machine languages, you know, they spend all their lives focused on machine languages, yet they can still function. I mean, that's really weird. I mean, you talk about weirdness. That's really what we're doing here is actually much more natural to us, very natural to us, actually. We feel on very familiar ground, ultimately, here. You know, we're going towards familiar ground, whereas machine language is going to very, ultimately, very unfamiliar ground, even though those who are doing it have a lot of practice in it in other lives. It still has a really weird feel to it, going into a dead end, and trying to make lies true. That's very unnatural for us, very unnatural. Whereas what we're doing is dropping the arrogance. That feels much more natural to us. We say, yeah, that leads back to naturalness for us. Leads back to true familiarity with truth. So we get more confident as we go along. We don't act in bizarre ways and wild person ways, and you know, maybe sometimes people go through phases of that. If they go through a valuing of the world phase, they might intentionally do those kind of things and all of that. But that's just a phase. We're not eccentric or bizarre or anything like that. We're disciplined. Try to be severely modest, for the most part, on the path. And there are times you may go through some acting out of value of the world, seeing is this really valuable? Is acting out this way, acting out that way, really valuable? And then you see, oh no, not no, it's not really. It's not worth dying for. It's not worth suffering. It's not worth. No, it's not really, is it? And so, you know. Those times you might look somewhat eccentric, but you might be doing it consciously and on purpose, actually, and not because you're whacked out or freaked out or on drugs or anything like that. Is you're aware that this is a spiritual discipline. You're actually very focused and disciplined and aware, you know, that you're intentionally appearing this way just to see, does this have value, is this really valuable? And then ultimately you realize, you know, oh no, it doesn't have value. It doesn't really have value, does it? Okay, and then at some point you can just drop it, you know, and just say, okay. And then he may seem like, you know, Joe or Jane hippie, and then one day someone sees you and they don't even recognize you, and you got short hair, no beard, you know, clothes are conservative clothes, and you're very conservative and very severely modest and everything. And they say, yeah, what, you know, what happened? You know, what? I don't get it. I thought that was you. And I said, no, that was never me. That was never me. I was just going through a phase. I was just examining, you know, if this had any value to it. Yeah, and just like, wow. Someone saw a picture of me when I was younger or something, and they said, is that you? That can't be you. What are you talking about? That's not you. What? They just like freaked them out. And so you just, you know, but the important thing is awareness, intent, discipline, determination, staying engaged in the spiritual path, managing your success. Yeah, do you occasionally run across people like that? You know, someone who's like a rock star, used to be a rock star, and now they're like, you know, this very devoted meditator or something. They say, why, how's that possible? What do you mean? You know, they say, no, actually, I was just, you know, I just wanted to see, is the rock star life, is that really have value? And I recognize it doesn't. It doesn't have value. It's just camouflage for arrogance, you know, and so, you know, and so then I recognize it, and I just dropped it. So like for me, I was never really part of any scene because I was really just looking at it in terms of does it have a real value to it. I guess people recognize that, oh, he's not a lifer. He's not really committed to it. You know, not really committed. Not, he's not going to continue on. You can't really be friends because it's not really, there's something that's a little bit of detachment there in some way, you know. So never really, and it's true. That's true. They say, no, he's going to be moving on at some point. He's going to be moving on. He's after something, and I don't know what it is, but moving on. And that's what happens, yeah. And so you can be like that too. You can be like that too. You don't have to get stuck in any of your, you know, valuing of the world, looking at it. You can see through it and say, oh, okay, I don't need to do that anymore. Done with that. And then like your intention is freed from it, and you're no longer interested, and just you realize that doesn't have any value. This lifestyle, that lifestyle, this doesn't have any more value. Really, it doesn't. I mean, just thinking recently about, the obsession that people have with homes, houses. It's really a fixation, incredible fixation. They're so into their houses and getting better houses and improving their houses. And I've got to do this. I've got to do this. You know? It's just like, wow, I don't have that obsession at all anymore. I worked through that and have actually been in my work. I actually work on that and people's obsessions with their homes and seeing it, and somehow this has eroded my own obsession with homes and houses, and it just doesn't matter. You know, it just doesn't matter really anymore. You know, a palace or living in a monastic cell or a palace is pretty much the same. Yeah, it doesn't matter. You know, just not fixated on homes the way people are fixated on their homes and their houses. And I understand what they're doing, but they're overly fixated on it. They're overly fixated. They're obsessed with it. And they move a lot. People move a lot. I can't understand that at all. They move. I got to get a better house. I got to get a better house. Now, this is the one that I'm looking for. That one wasn't quite right. Here's a better one. Here's a better one. Let me get this one. Now, let me fix this up. I got to do this and this and this. And their whole lives are consumed by their fixation on homes and houses. I mean, you got a kitchen. You got a refrigerator. You got a bathroom. You got a bedroom. I mean, you just got the bay. You know, what more do you need? Sit on a bench and meditate. You got a bench? Well, then use it. People have these patios. They have all these places. I see there's so many incredible gardens and places in, and they never use it. They're too busy making more money to buy something better or to fix something. And it never stops. Where they never take it easy. That's amazing. I see so many nice places, and people just simply don't really utilize them at all. Whereas what I've finally done is I've actually utilized this place to, you know, an ultimate extent. I just said, hey, it's time to stop trying to improve things and just utilize it. And it's turned out beautiful, tremendous. Yeah, nothing wrong with having a nice house, but don't get fixated on it. Utilize it. You have a nice sofa, nice living room, sit on the sofa and meditate and read, contemplate, use it. Use your house. Don't let it use you. You got a little seat somewhere, a little nook somewhere, use it. Make it your meditation space. Make it your practice space. This is just intelligent means, skillful means. Meanwhile, everybody's else searching for a better spot. I haven't quite found the spot yet. You know, and they spend their whole lives searching for a better spot, improving the better spot. And once they make an improvement here, they look for another place to make an improvement. And then another place, and then another place. And I say, how much time have you actually spent? You got this place, like, overlooking the ocean. This beautiful, I mean, oh my gosh, what a beautiful place to concentrate here on spaciousness. You know, how much do you actually use this? I might have spent a couple hours here or something, but you know, I was just too busy and crazy. They could have been spending 2 hours every day there meditating for year after year after year after year after year. Imagine this, the momentum they had, the success they'd be having if they did that. Instead, they're looking for a better spot. Never ends. Just looking for a better spot. Do the best with the spot that you have right now. My spot for 20 years was a chair. Just one chair, that's it. Just a chair in a room, that's it. That was my spot. I said, this is good enough. I got a chair, I got a little table next to the chair, and I got a book. I got a book and I got a light. What more do I need? That's enough. Read the book. Consider what's being said. Sit in the chair. Drink some water. Read some more. You know, use your situation that you have. Don't continually be sucked into the materialistic effort to say, wait a minute, I need to find something better. I need to find better. I need to find better before I can get started. I'm ready to get started, except this isn't quite good enough for me. I need to find something better. This is what the whole world, you know, engages in, basically. Or they kind of wistfully say, well, I wish I had something better. I really can't get it. And they just never end up using what they have. If you need to sit on the ground, sit on the ground. That works too. That works too. If you want to sit in a tree, sit in a tree. Sometimes kids make tree forts, right? They go up in the tree. They want to get away from the world. And they go up there and say, nobody allowed. This is my meditation place. And this is where I can focus. You know, this is where I can experience my, you know, imagination unbound by what the world is demanding of me. So the kids are very defensive about their tree forts. Kids are good at utilizing whatever's there, right? Like, four kids, they want to play soccer. They don't have a soccer ball. They get some tape or something and just wrap it up in tape and use a ball of tape or what, you know, whatever. They can, like that. That's good enough. People build a church, and then they say, "Yeah, well, we need to build a better church. We need to improve this one. Let's make an even better one, and then let's work hard to pay that one off." And yeah, you know, just sit where you are. Now, again, don't be an extremist about it. I mean, I put a lot of work into, for to say the least, into this area here. Incredible amount of work, actually, over the years, and you know, finally, I just felt like, you know, that's enough. So you may, you know, feel that you need to get things a certain way. And we're not trying to be extremists here, and but just keep this in mind, the basic issue. At some point, you just say, hey, you know, this is good enough. This is good enough. This is good enough. Stop fooling around here. Stop updating your equipment. You know, you can get caught up in that too, which I certainly understand that, is constantly updating your equipment, I need something better, I need something better. If only I had something better. Ultimately, I just said, whatever I got, I may just use it the best I can. And then my camera actually, it broke. I got a very cheap camera, $100, and ultimately it broke after a couple of years. And now I'm just using this webcam here, which, you know, I'm sure it'll at some point it'll break too. Everything's made to break these days. Yeah, just a simple webcam, and that's it. And this computer is like, how old now is it? It's quite old, actually. Maybe seven years old now. I don't know, something like that, 8 years. It's pretty old by standard computers. And that's it. Cheap headphones from Radio Shack. And just you know, I went through periods of obsessing about microphones. I said, my equipment was never good enough to get started. I said, I'll get started as soon as my equipment is really good enough. I thought that, you know, this deserves the best equipment. And you just end up wasting years and years and years and years of your life like that. Whereas here, it's just like, you know, basic, simple stuff. Very simple. And it's the message that's important, you know. Now, so now I realize I don't need anything sophisticated. Don't let that get in your way. And again, we're not extremists. You can do some work. You can improve a little bit occasionally. Do little things, but don't let it slow you down for even a day. You know, if what you're doing is preventing it, slowing you down to the point where you're not really putting your practice in, then you're overdoing it. So I'm struck by those, like, recording studios, various recording studios, how simple they were. We think it's some sophisticated palace, you know, there. You see it, you say, that's impossible. What do you mean? They rent some store, it used to be a laundromat or something, or, you know, things like that. It's just some old building, some dingy old building just on the corner of a street, and rats in the ceiling, and just, you know, old, And they say, okay, we're going to lease this place, and they put in, get their recording equipment in, and there's a room, and they put all the musicians in the room and put some little dividers up a little bit and put some mics up, and they start recording, and they make this incredible music there. Some of the best music ever made has just been in these very small, simple commercial buildings that are nondescript. You know, it's just amazing. I'm just stunned by it. The reverb chambers they use. I mean, some guy, David Gold of Gold Studios, built his own reverb chambers, but through all sorts of experimentation, through the years, just working on it, and finally came up with something, said maybe this will work, and it turned out to work fabulously well. And I just use a simple 12-inch speaker and a RCA microphone, diaphragm microphone, in there, and that's it. They just have the sound, whatever sound they want to put through the speaker, whether it might be vocals, go into the reverb chamber, and the microphones in the reverb chamber picking up the vocals being reverbing throughout the chamber and going back to the mixing board. And they just then control the amount from that microphone into the mix. They use the dry mix from the vocalist, and then they add some, you know, reverb mix into that, depending on how much they want. And is that simple? Because that's simple. And the chamber is just like a couple of trapezoids, which are basically squares that aren't quite square. You know, the sides kind of angle a little bit like this. A couple of trapezoids. And then other reverb chambers put in like pipes, big pipes. And it's thick cement, very thick plaster type of cement on the walls. So everything, you know, bounces beautifully and hits the pipes. And that gives some more reverberation in the reverb chambers, and this is one of the keys to the great sound of you know, recorded music is these reverb chambers they use. It just, it makes it seem like you're listening to like you're in church, or you're listening to something that is, you know, big and spacious, and where really they're just sitting in a tiny little room, like 20 by 20 room. Actually, Srinivasagarada Maharaj gave all the satsangs like a 20 by 16 foot room upstairs, you know, across the streets were the public latrines in Mumbai. People jam into this 20 by 16 or something like that. It's a very small room, you know, and this is where some of, you know, very intense spiritual teaching took place in relatively modern times, and gave a big boost to our spiritual confidence here. Actually, Sagarada Maharaj, having many Western students, and having the book "I Am That" by the name slips me right now, but in English, published in English, and he related to Westerners. He was talking to Westerners a lot of it with an interpreter. This gave the West a lot of confidence. He said, "Hey, you know, we have this enlightened being who's relating to us and accepting us and saying, you can do it. Do it right now. You're already it. Just accept it right now. Everything is it. There's no inside, no outside." You know, it just, and this actually helped the West out a lot. We got a lot of confidence out of that. And it was just a tiny little room. It wasn't some big sprawling, you know, spiritual complex with gardens and a big palace and temples, and the guru comes into this colonnaded, you know, audience area where there's thousands of devotees and there's music, musicians and attendees and stuff like that, and the guru, you know, gives darshan to everybody, and they all, now he's in this little cramped little room with fans going, you know, and people are sweating, it's so hot, and he just saying, hey, you know, you're already, this is it, I am that right now. There's no inside, no outside, just thatness, you know, just suchness, just isness, right nowness, right here nowness. And, you know, why can't you do it? What are you telling me? You say, what do you mean you got problems? Just come experience what I'm experiencing right now. And then tell me if you have any questions, okay? And if you need any answers. Why should I give you answers? You don't need answers. Just come and experience what I'm experiencing, you know? And pushing. And, you know, the Westerners got this and said, oh, hey, you know, We can do this. Just a tiny little place. And Punjaji, same thing. Is started out in Lucknow, a very small in a living room or something started out. It was very, you know, and then they eventually there's this little area. It wasn't big, it was cramped. It was cramped and small. Just like those great recording studios. Gold Star Recording Studios. Hollywood, American studios in Memphis, and then in Muscle Shoals, they had, I can't remember the name of the studio, but these little famous studios, you know, they pumped out this incredible music. So we don't have to wait for some palace. We don't have to build some massive complex before we get it, you know? It doesn't have to be that way. So for me, I just said, hey, I'm not going to wait around until something great happens. I'm going to start working as best I can. Let me just start taping right here, right now, and keep at it. And you know, it's very humble. There's nothing's happening here. And so what? Just don't wait for that. Stop pursuing the trappings of spirituality, and just work, and manage your success, and do the best you can, and get after right where you are, and then let the chips fall wherever they may. I don't know. I don't have a vision of the future, really, in terms of that. I really don't know. I'm not really focused on that. I'm focused on right here, right now, you know, doing the best I can. And this is the focus that you should have wherever you are, is right here, right now. What's the best I can do right here, right now? And, of course, we're saying no inside, no outside. Where do you have to be to realize no inside, no outside at all? There isn't any beingness. Beingness doesn't have an inside and outside. Where do you have to be to realize that? Do you have to be in Kathmandu, for instance? No, you don't, do you? Do you have to be on top of Mount Everest? No, you don't. Can you just be right where you are? Yes, you can. Since there isn't no inside or outside anywhere. There's no upside, no downside. No this side, no that side. There's no pathness to it. As Krishnamurti said, the truth is a pathless land. So, right where you are, right where everyone is, they're all equally disposed to this realization. Right where everyone is equally disposed to this realization, actually. Driving a taxi cab. Or maybe you're on your commute. Maybe you're just sitting in your room. Maybe in a cubicle, maybe in a classroom, maybe walking somewhere. Just wherever you are, everyone is equally disposed to this realization. Wherever they find themselves, they're actually equally disposed to everyone else. There's no one who's more disposed to it than anyone else. Nobody. Everyone is equally disposed, wherever they are. Whatever ghetto they're living in, we're all living in a ghetto, to tell you the truth, a ghetto of non-recognition. Of course, when you live in a ghetto, you're obsessed with perks, aren't you? And so you think we'd be able to all get along. So they realize, hey, we're all in the same ghetto, really, of non-recognition. So let's get along here. But instead of that, everybody's frantically trying to get some sort of, you know, perks. They want this parking space. Did you feel? We want to feel like VIPs in some way. I experienced that today, where there's this long line, and I have an account, and I didn't have to wait in the line. And so. I just breezed past this. I didn't have to wait, you know, saved like a half an hour of waiting or something. I said, wow, I'm a VIP today. So we enjoy that, right? We say, oh, isn't that great? I feel like I had a perk right there. And so we all are frantically struggling for some sort of perks just to try and, you know, wash the bitter taste out of our mouths just a little bit here. I mean, life, our situation we're experiencing here is so bitter for us. It's so ghettoized. We're absolutely ghettoized. We don't recognize that. We don't want to because we're too busy posing, you know, as if we're, you know, king or queen of the ghetto. Like, I'm not as ghetto as you. That kind of thing. Well, no, we're all very ghetto here. And, you know, why waste our time trying to say I'm not quite as ghetto as you? That's ridiculous. You know, get out of the ghetto is the goal, not to try and, you know, say I've got a little parking space here and you don't, or I've got nice blinds, got better blinds than you do, better curtains, better sofa, I have better, you know, a better car than you do. These are little, you know, status things, these little perks we think that, you know, at least the ghetto taste is not as bitter in my mouth as it is in yours. You know, but those are very minor kind of things that we need to just kind of figure out and realize it's not that important. I don't want to waste my time with that. I shop at a better market than you do. I shop at Whole Foods or something. Whole Paycheck. We call it Whole Paycheck because that's what's going to happen to you if you go in there. And you know, what are you doing shopping at that ghetto supermarket, you know? And buying that ghetto food has probably got a bunch of stuff in it that I'm getting, you know, organic. My food's more organic than yours, you know. Look at this whole thing now, right? It's just people get obsessed. My food's more organic than yours. So I'm not as ghettoized as you are. Really? If you really look at it, you know, it the bitterness, the taste of the grave is everyone's tasting ashes here. Except those who are enlightened. So we better be enlightened. Enlightenment is not an option, it's a necessity. It's ultimately a mandate, actually, for everyone. You know, if someone leaves the ghetto and is successful and they move to a nice suburban place and the people say, they betrayed us. They're not, you know, who do they think they are? Come back to the ghetto. You can't leave the ghetto. And it's tough for people to leave the ghetto here. Well, it's the same with enlightenment. I mean, you leave the ghetto of arrogance. Arrogance is just a wasteland. And, you know, you're not going to go back to that. Say, no, I'm free of that. I'm living the exalted life now, that is for sure. And of course they might be, you know, bitter about that, like, I'm still tasting these ashes, it's horrible. But they have to cut through their arrogance enough to say, okay, let me get into this mood of repentance here. Let me get into the mood of repentance, it's the only way. Cannot make progress if you stay in your arrogant mind. If you stay in your arrogance, you can't make progress on the path. You'll just try to keep making lies true. And you may go to a teacher and say, hey, you know, how did you make lies true? I'm really interested. How'd you do that? Again, arrogating to them a situation that doesn't exist. They'll insist that, no, you found a way to make lies true. I know you did. Now you got to help me. You got no choice, but you got to help me. And you got to do it that way. And no, that's just arrogance. We didn't make lies true. We dropped our arrogance. Again, managing our success. If we find ourselves in a situation where someone's enlightened, it's just like, okay, well, that's great. Manage your success with that situation. You keep, you know, stay grounded in your spiritual discipline. And accept, yeah, this is happening. This really is happening. This really is happening. And it's supposed to happen because I'm grounded in my discipline. And I have to do it. There's a mandate. Nobody can escape this. Necessity. So I'm just doing what has to be done. And I'm not arrogantly asserting that I can avoid it by making lies true. That's all. So when you find yourself in an adventitious situation, maybe that's the wrong use of the word, helpful situation. When you find yourself in a helpful situation, you say, okay, I just have to accept it because this, you know, the price I'm paying for dropping my arrogance, this is what comes upon me. And I have to now get used to this. I have to get used to it. Yeah, I mean, at some point, you know, you're going to be enlightened and you'll be aware of enlightened beings and, you know, you'll go big time. It's everyone will at some point go big time, that's something you have to accept. That's part of success. If you're a ball player, you want to play baseball, you know, you start out in the minor leagues. If you got talent, you work your way, you keep working at it really hard, you learn your craft, and eventually you realize, hey, eventually I'm going to end up in the big leagues, and eventually I may even be an all-star, you know, I may, you know, and be on a winning team, et cetera, et cetera. So you just have to stay grounded in your work ethic. just keep learning your craft, stay grounded in it, and then these things happen. You just have to say, okay, yeah, this is what I have to now put up with. I got to get familiar with it. I can't arrogantly assert that, oh, I don't deserve this. That's arrogance. What do you mean? How can we say I don't deserve to be enlightened? That's utter arrogance. That's like saying I don't deserve to be what I am. That is arrogance. That's telling God what God deserves, actually. Saying, God, you don't deserve your son, your spirit that you created to be what it is. You deserve it to be something different. It's total arrogance. So to say that, no, I don't deserve this is arrogance. So when you drop your arrogance, then you find out you'll find yourself in better and better situations, actually. Yeah, we're in a pretty good situation here in some ways. You know, really, compared to the rest of the world. Are you kidding? We're in a vastly better situation here compared to the world. Yeah, we deserve it. We have to accept the fact we absolutely deserve it. And ultimately, we'll deserve even better and better and better. Yeah. How are we doing here? We're doing great. Doing great. This is fantastic. Just breezing along. People, like if they have wealthy people have estates of horses, you know, horse riding, they think nothing of taking a horse ride from the morning for a couple hours. Okay, well, why can't we spend a couple hours taking a spiritual horse ride like this? Who's the nobility, actually? Right? Who has the better estate? You can go to Montecito, you know, and go, you could have gone go riding with, you know, with the, you know, the big wigs up in the hills and the mountains above Santa Barbara and the ranches and all that stuff, you know. President Reagan used to do that. And so you could do that. You can go riding with the big wigs. Horse riding, but we could go spiritual horse riding here. Who owns the better estate, actually, is the question. I say I have the better estate here for sure. Who's the nobility? Who has the big estate? It was the Sargana Maharaj had the bigger estate, didn't he? A little room, upstairs room, one room apartment. He had the bigger estate. Because he was taking people on a tremendous horse ride through a tremendously scenic territory. Very invigorating. You know, very wowish. So in that way we are the nobility. We're the ones with the better estate for sure, way better. Because we're the ones that are enjoying our estate, getting more enjoyment out of our estate than the ones with the big spreads. That is for sure. I know people who have, you know, spreads in the mountains, and they go hunting, they go fishing, they have their own lake and all this kind of stuff, Yeah, what'd you do this weekend? Well, we went out wild boar hunting, and we went out deer hunting, and, you know, whatever they do, and hunting for quail, and, you know, yeah, we had a good time doing chopping wood, and they're like, okay, nice, that's great. Well, they never asked what I did. What did I do? Yeah, well, I spent, you know, 7 hours taping, and went through this fantastic clarity and recognition. It was just like, I'm so saturated in the wow, I can hardly, I'm just quiet, you know, I'm so wowed out by this. So who's more wowed out? The one that has the estate with the lake and the hunting grounds and the deer park, so to speak, and are just sitting here on a little bench? Who has the better estate? I do. By a long shot. It's not even comparable. You know, who has the real palace? The real palace is right here. Who's enjoying their home most, right? Someone who has, I mean, I go into houses with, there's Picasso's on the wall. You know, there's famous painters, paintings, originals on the walls. I mean, a lot. I go into homes with incredible amount of artwork, very, very valuable artwork. And everything is so nice. I mean, just the houses are just so tricked out. And you know, they're busy in their house, in their kitchen, and they're... But they're busy basically saying, what do I need to do next? What do I need to do? I need to make it. Everything, this isn't quite right here. This isn't quite. And I'm just sitting here on a bench here. You know, who has the better estate, actually? I go to places with incredible swimming pools and patios and greenery and landscaping. And you just, wow. But how are they using it? How are they using it? Okay, we're here, just a simple little bench. Some dirt and a bench. Who has the better estate? Who's getting more use out of their place is the question. Who has a better estate? I do. Way better. Don't have any artwork hanging on the walls at all. Don't even have any wallpaper on the walls. this little background here was, I was fortunate to get that as a, just someone was tossing it away. And just tack it up there. There you go. We don't need anything more. It works for me. So I have the better estate. That is for sure. Because I found that the people in these incredible homes, they don't really, they're not really happy or enjoying them. Then they're struggling. They're trying to pay for them. They're trying to get something better. They're, you know, it's a struggle. And I remember some man had this original painting. It's a famous painting, actually, very famous painting. He has the original. It's huge. He has a whole room where it's there, and he has a room, and he sits in the room, and he says, "Look at this painting. Come on, I want to show you this." And he shows me this painting. He says, "What do you think?" It's a very, very nice painting for sure. And he says, "I just sit here. I sit here, and there's all this beautiful glass and sofas." And he said, "I like to sit here and just, you know that I have this painting, and I do that." I said, "Well, that's cool. That's great." Unfortunately, he has dementia. But, okay, showed me other paintings. This is really expensive. This one's expensive. And they want to impress. You know, they want me to be impressed by, well, I have all these expensive paintings. I said, well, okay, but you know, just sitting and looking at some painting isn't necessarily, you know, is wowish as we're doing. Who has the bigger wow here? You know, we're breezing through tremendous territory here. Landscapes of freedom. You know, we're traveling through landscapes of freedom. Who's traveling better? You know, who has, you know, the real better graphics, so to speak? Actually, I spent time last night, or all day yesterday, actually, it was all day working on graphics of Jesus, and I was able to put together just mind-blowing graphics. And there was one graphic of Jesus as the Panto creator or something like that. It is the best painting I've ever seen of Jesus. It was profound. It was just incredible. It was so stunning. The look on the face, the intensity there, that finally I had to quit working. I just couldn't take it anymore. I said, that's enough. I've had enough. This is just too intense. And I was working on these amazing graphics. You know, okay, you talk about paintings. I had way more better graphics than these people with these paintings in their home. And then who travels better as far as traveling? We travel through landscapes of freedom here. Who has better traveling? We do here. Way better traveling. Because what better landscapes are there to see than landscapes of freedom? What better buildings are there to see than buildings that represent freedom? You know, buildings of clarity and of concepts pointing to truth. You know, buildings that we see are buildings that are established on the ground of being. You know, on landscapes of freedom. We see all our cities are on landscapes of freedom. You know, we travel through those cities. We stay in those cities. So who's really traveling the world better? I am. I am by going nowhere. I go nowhere. You know, who's looking out on the vistas, beautiful vistas? Who has a better vista? I mean, I go to places that rich people have the best views, you know, around. I mean, they just have these looking out on the whole valley and just, you know, just gorgeous views. But who has a better view? I'm looking on the vistas of freedom. I'm looking at vistas of spaciousness, of vistas of being. Who has the better vistas? Who has the better view? I do. I have a way better view here. Who has better garden landscaping? My landscaping here is landscaping of plants in freedom, plants in beingness, you know, in a landscape of freedom. It's got better landscaping here for sure. Don't even have to water it or maintain it. You don't have to cut any of those hedges of freedom, as it were. Yeah, you look at it that way, and you ask, well, who's richer, who's wealthier, who's better off? You know, where's the nobility in the world? Well, you know, this is where it's at. This is where it's at. I'm wealthier than those people. I'm wealthier than the billionaires. Way, way more wealthy. I travel better. I live better. I have better art. I have better everything. Better everything. Everything by far is incomparable. Incomparable, actually. I just don't want to tell them. You know, I was kind of afraid to tell these. You know, that's a secret. I don't want to hurt their feelings. But you know, at some point, you got to speak up a little bit, probably, and say, "Hey, you know, this is where the wealth is really at. This is what a life is really about." There's some graphics I worked. I just had to stop. I said, I can't take it anymore. I just can't take it anymore. This is too much. Really. It's like, oh my gosh, are you kidding me? But that's actually pretty ghetto-ish, actually, graphics. That's the ghetto in me. Still, I still have the ghetto-ness of looking at graphics, which is really nothing compared to, you know, what we're doing here is seeing the freedom, recognizing the freedom. How are we doing on this video? Ah, we're getting up there almost. This is way beyond even the best graphics. Even the best graphics you can come up with cannot really touch this type of, you know, sharing like this. No, it cannot. But if we're going to be ghetto, we might as well stay in touch with our spiritual path. You know, keep, you know, work. If you're going to work with graphics, work with, you know, work with Jesus, or work with something that really inspires you, whatever it may be, that is directly, you can directly link it to your spiritual path and getting to beingness, and, you know, just keep it very severely modest. And stay in the mood of repentance. Make sure your graphic work stays in the mood of repentance. Okay, otherwise it can pull you away very badly, actually. Now, very interesting, I was working on the graphics and I felt like, you know what, I kind of feel like some music, because I'm kind of lagging here. Music is really can be a stimulant. So I put on a playlist on YouTube, and it slowed the computer down so badly that nothing would work. And I said, wow, this is a dilemma, because I realized I had to choose between working with these Jesus images and graphics, or listening to the music. I couldn't do both at the same time. I could not. My computer couldn't handle it. So ultimately, I decided to, you know, click and shut the window, shut the YouTube window, and that's it. No more music. And then I went on and continued to work with, you know, the graphics got better and better and better. It was just fabulous, but no music to it. And I said, I had to make a choice, and I decided, you know, no music. No music. Just like I walked by this, it's real hot today, really. And this place had this cooler of Coca-Cola. And I decided, no, I can't. I couldn't have taken free drinks. And I said, well, if it's free, you know, you can't fault me for taking that, you know. So I said, I can. There's a nice classic Coca-Cola. Let me just, you know. And I thought, you know, I can either, if I drink that Coke, I'm not going to be able to tape tonight because I'll be using a stimulant and it's going to mess everything up. You just can't do that. And I was very tempted. It was so hot and it was ice cold with ice in this cooler. I just felt, I can just guzzle that Coke and it tastes great. But I said, I decided just with my will, I just walked past it and out the door and I was shaking. I said, no, can't do it. Can't do it. And I ended up being able, took a nap for an hour and ended up be able to do this taping. I had enough energy to do it, you know, and no stimulants, you know, at all. You can't do this with stimulants. You cannot. There's a certain art to this that stimulants interfere with it very badly. That's why I don't use music on these videos too. Music is very much a stimulant. You can use music, it you know, we use it for various ways, but it oftentimes is used to get you going. Like in the morning, I go to work, sometimes I'll be humming a song to get myself going, you know, some sort of song that just pumps me up, makes me feel like I've got some energy for the day, and it, you know, it's a stimulant. You have to be very careful about that. And you lose the flow and the art of this and the depth of it. And the sensitivity of it if you do that. Okay, so we're about to lose this feed here in capturing this video as we have hit the, we're about to hit the wonderful 231.09 mark, which means we have completed another tremendous adventure here. Very rich adventure. We are truly rich beyond most people's understanding, to say the very least here. We're the fortunate ones. We're the ones who are, you know, getting out of the ghetto. That is for sure. And experiencing the riches that are available to us outside the ghetto of arrogance. Okay, we're doing it, and the fruits of this will continue to come. Manage your success. Continue to manage your success. Okay, very great. That's it. We're going to the end of the 09-ness here. Okay.